all of you for being very attentive, and I'll be happy to take any question.
Across India, thank you so much, Dr. Sabu, and the whole team of DiaCare to invite me here. I'm going to speak about a very important topic on how we can make changes, effective changes in a patient with diabetes. I'm going to start with a case scenario, and I'm going to look at how we can make changes in a diabetic based on
I think he's lost contact.
kidney, because kidney seems to be the driver of metabolic issues. And we know there are a lot of metabolic issues in people with diabetes, which drives the global pandemic or epidemic of cardiovascular disease and chronic kidney disease. Now, we have this middle-aged businessman who's on SU plus med, HbA1c is 8.4, he's a hypertensive. In physical examination, he's overweight, his ECG is normal. We have an option of adding on, increasing his metformin, or we have or we could add an SGLT2 DPP4 SU or a low dose pioglitazone. So you have a lot of things. It's a buffet cafeteria approach. We'll see what we should add on and how over the last few years we have actually changed from being a glucose centric to something where there is a paradigm shift in us that we need to control based on the comorbidity of this of patients. Now, if you look at the glycemic reduction with canagliflozin, it has the highest reduction of 24.1% as compared to many other in terms of its postprandial control. If you look at weight and glycemic effects of an SGLT or canagliflozin as an add-on to metformin, you can see it's probably the best in class when it comes to an A1C and body weight reduction. We all know that there are a lot of fat stores, fat depots in our system, whether it's in the liver, kidney, pancreas, and they crosstalk and they finally cause us to explode into cardiovascular chronic kidney disease. So anything which removes or reduces the visceral fat is associated with significant improvement in cardiovascular risk factors at 1 year. And data this presented almost in 2017 suggests that canagliflozin does reduce visceral adipose tissue more as compared to subcutaneous adipose tissue. And you see a 2 to 6 kilogram weight loss is seen in clinical practice. Again, how it causes blood pressure reduction. We all know that there is a hemodynamic effect, natriuresis effect, diuretic effect, weight loss, uric acid reduction, and probably inhibition of the sympathetic nervous system. So a lot of pathways are involved in the reduction of blood pressure as well. If you look at the data from the CANVAS program, which had one-third of the patients with prior CV event or established cardiovascular disease, and one-third of patients who were risk factors, and canagliflozin for primary and secondary prevention of cardiovascular events. If you look at its endpoints, which are related to the kidney, you will see that as secondary endpoints on the CANVAS study, you had a good all the endpoints of the kidney favoring canagliflozin, whether it was progression of albuminuria, 40% reduction in eGFR, 40% reduction in eGFR in patients who had established cardiovascular disease. So renal protection with canagliflozin is because of the induced sustained lowering of albuminuria, preventing the progression in albuminuria, regression in albuminuria, and also causing a reduced renal function loss. We all know that the eGFR reduces with albuminuria as well as the duration of diabetes increases. If you look at reduction in progression and induced regression of albuminuria from the CANVAS study, there's a 27% reduction in progression of albuminuria and 1.7 times regression of albuminuria. If you look at CV risk reduction, there's a 36% reduction in the risk of HHF or hospitalization due to heart failure in this particular population, and a 21% reduction in all-cause mortality. This is the reason that that canagliflozin got the 3-point MACE indication from the US FDA. If you look at of our case, where we started with an HbA1c of 8.4, just with the addition of canagliflozin, we not only reduce his HbA1c, but we also cause a reduction in his BMI, his blood pressure, ensure renal protection. We gave a drug which will prevent him from progressing into heart failure and also a mortality risk reduction. Now, we all know that diabetic nephropathy or diabetic kidney disease is very prevalent. It is prevalent in almost 30 to 40% of our patients with type 2 diabetes. CKD reduces lifespan by almost 16 years, and this is something that we need to establish that many of our patients with chronic kidney disease may not progress to the end stage renal disease, but would have a cardiovascular event prematurely and take them away from us. So here we have a patient who's 58 years of age by metformin 1.5, hypothyroid on statins and levothyroxine. Adherence is questionable. BMI is 25, HbA1c is 8.2. She's in stage 3A chronic kidney disease with a creat of 1.6 and EGFR of 47. Lipids seems to be okay, blood pressure borderline. Should we continue metformin? HbA1c is higher, or should we put her on either it could be an SGLT2, GLP-1, DPP-4 insulin. So we have a lot of drugs that we can actually use, but we know that this patient is in stage 3B chronic kidney disease. We have two fantastic data. One is credence from canagliflozin, and then we have the DAPA-CKD from dapagliflozin, which clearly tells us that patients who are in stage 3 chronic kidney disease are at very high risk for cardiovascular and chronic kidney events. And it's imperative on our part and ethically right on our part to intervene with SGLT2 inhibitors, either a CANA or a DAPA, to make sure we prevent progression of chronic kidney disease and also treat chronic kidney disease. Data from the canagliflozin's credence study, which came in the which came in Australian Association of Nephrology meeting, looked at 4,400 patients with a USCR more than 300, 62 years, EGFR was 57, ACR average was approximately 1,000. They were put on ACE and they were put on canagliflozin versus placebo. 90 to 95% of patients were on dosage which prevent progression of chronic kidney disease in terms of ACE or ARB, which are stabilized based on blood pressure control. Primary outcome was doubling of creatinine, death due to cardiovascular or kidney disease or end-stage renal failure. As you can see that there was a 30% reduction in the primary outcome. There was, if you look at only renal outcome in terms of a harder endpoint of end-stage kidney disease, 32% reduction. The number needed to treat for the primary outcome was 21, which is very significant. And for the renal outcome and a hard end is 42. We didn't find any features of amputation and fractures. So in patients with type 2 diabetes and kidney disease, canagliflozin reduces the risk of kidney failure and cardiovascular events. So if you look at the milestone of credence, it has a 1 year milestone. The DCGI was also approved it for the indication in March 2020. So it's a big win for diabetic kidney disease, where today, apart from ACE and ARB, you can add an SGLT2, canagliflozin or dapagliflozin as of today, and make sure we can prevent the progression of chronic kidney disease in these patients. If you look at credence in terms of primary outcome, as I said, a 30% reduction in primary outcome. If you look at the reduction in EGFR, it prevents the EGFR reduction, which normally would have gone at almost 5 ml per hour to 1.85 ml per hour. That's a 60% reduction in the EGFR decline. If you look at the projected effects on EGFR, if you take a typical credence patient who is at 63 years and EGFR of 56, and we intervene with an SGLT2 canagliflozin, we are going to prevent the primary event and the EGFR decline, the need for dialysis, by at least 15 years. That's a 15 years dialysis-free life gain for that patient. Multiple mechanism of renal protection, reduction in intraglomerular pressure, reduction of BP and arterial stiffness, increased natriuresis, reduces inflammation, increased efficiency of substrate, reduces albuminuria, increased renal oxygenation, approved by the US FDA to reduce the risk of end-stage kidney disease, doubling of creatinine, CV death and HHF in adults with type 2 diabetes and diabetic nephropathy with albuminuria more than 300. Again, DCG has also approved it for the same indication in March 2020. Again, if you look at the number needed to treat for renal outcome over 2.5 years, primary composite outcome just 28. If you look at renal outcome 28, primary outcome was 22, renal outcome 28. If hardest endpoint of a renal outcome, which is end-stage kidney disease 43, all impressive. So this lady who's 58-year-old would go on canagliflozin over a period of time. Why we chose canagliflozin? Because we would prevent a progression of diabetic kidney disease, would help her in a weight control, would help her in a cardiovascular disease, prevent 3-point MACE, and also prevent hospitalization due to heart failure, which is a very common adverse events in patients with chronic kidney disease. Thank you all for a patient hearing, and I hope I've added some value to your practice and you can extrapolate it to your clinical strategy. Thank you so much.